Okay. So if this is visible means we can start with the classes.
Visible.
Okay. So see, till yesterday, so we have started this topic from on threads, and we have gone through the two sessions. So we have learned few things. One thing is we have first we have learned the difference between the process-based multitasking and the thread-based multitasking. After that, we have studied how to create a thread. How to create a thread. For that also, we have studied two methods. So one was like implementing the runnable interface, and the other one was by extending the thread class. So these two things we learned, and also how to give a name for the thread, what is its default priority. So all these things we have seen. So all these things will come under some basics of that. And also we have seen about the sleep function. So like this, so there are so many functions. We have join function, we have isalive function. So all these things are there. So before understanding that, you should know the working of the thread, like how to create the thread. You should know how to create the thread. Once you create the thread, then you should know how to implement that. So thread will be in different states. So thread will be in running state. Thread will be in the waiting state. So you should decide. Know which functions are there to change the thread from one thread to another thread. So so today we'll talk about this thread model. So today we'll talk about thread model, which will give us it will tell us how to make use of the system, how to make use of this system efficiently. So how to make use of this system efficiently. So for that, we'll be using this thread model. So so first thing is, what is a thread? See, thread means, so for example, there can be multiple process within an operating system. So this is the operating system. So within the operating system, we can have process called P1, process called P2, and process called P3. So within this process, we can have threads T1, T2, T3, like that. So here also we can have some threads T1, T2, T3. So the naming can be anything. Here we have three threads. Process P2 is having three threads, and process P3 can have two threads. So like that. So thread means it can be used within a single process only. So within this process, P1 is having three threads, process P2 is having three threads, and process P3 is having two threads. So this can be used to perform multiple activities. So by using multiple activities, it will reduce the inefficiency. It will reduce the inefficiency by preventing the waste of CPU cycles. So at any point of time, the thread will be working. And also, thread is a very lightweight process, which will not consume so much of memory, the cost between the cost of communication between two threads will be very less. So all these factors will help in improving the efficiency of the system. And also thread can execute a series of statements. Thread can be used to execute the series of statements, all those things. So thread will have several states. So these are the states. These are the states in which the thread can exist. The thread can be in a state called new state. Thread can be in the new state. Thread can be in the runnable state. So we can have the thread in new state. We can have the thread in runnable state. We can have the thread in non-runnable state. We can have the thread in running state also. We can have the thread in running state. And we can have the thread, once it is done, it has to go to the terminated state. So these are the different stages of for a thread. So we have a thread can be in any of these states. It can be new state, it can be in runnable state, it can be in non-runnable state, it can be in running state, it can be in terminated state. So initially the thread will be in new state. After that it will transit to runnable state. So once it is in the runnable state, after transiting to runnable state, it will go to running state. So in the running state, if it is waiting for some printer, if it is waiting for some input from the user, the thread will go to the non-running state. So when you call the sleep function, the thread will go to the running to the non-running state, that is a paused state. So when you sleep, when you call a sleep function, or when the thread is waiting for an input from the user, or when you're calling the suspend function, when you're calling the wait function. So we have some functions like sleep function, we have functions like suspend function, we have functions like wait function. So all these functions will move the thread from the running state to the non-runnable state. So after some time, when you call some methods like notify all, or it is waiting for the input from the user, and the user has given the input to the thread. So once it has received the input from the user, again it will go to the runnable state. And from runnable state, it will continue and it will get transited to the running state. So once its action is completed, it will go to the terminated state. That is the last state. You can call it as a dead end state. So so these are the different states for a thread. So we have new state. So what is this new state? It is a state where the thread is ready to run. A thread will be in this new state when it is created, it will come to this state. So the thread will be in the new state when it gets the CPU time. It will come into this new state. So we have states like running state. So running state means when the thread is in execution, when the thread is getting executed, it is in the running state. So we have new state means it will get the news in the new state. It will get the CPU. When it has got the CPU time, it is in the new state. When the thread is executing, it is in the running state. So when the thread is not running, so that is in the suspended state. And we have blocked state also. We have blocked state in the sense it is waiting for an input from the user, it is waiting for some IO resources, or it is waiting for one thread. It wants to print some document, it wants to print some data, but the printer is not free. So this thread is in the blocked state. So it is in the waiting state. And also we have terminated state. When the thread stops its execution, we will call it as a terminated state. So these are the states of the thread. So the definition can be the new state. New state means when the CPU gets the thread gets the CPU. Running state means the thread under execution, you can call it as running. Suspended means the thread has been paused or it is temporarily inactive, it is not under execution. So that we will call it as the suspended state. Block state means it is waiting for some input from the user, or it is waiting for some resources to complete its action. So that is in the blocked state. And terminated state means when it has completed its execution, you can call it as the terminated state. So once it is terminated, it implies that its job is done. So these are the various stages. These are the various stages. So one should be aware of this. So any doubts here? Any doubts with respect to the stages? With respect to the stages, any doubts? Yes or no?
No, sir.
Okay. Okay, no doubts, right? So you can also see, we can also, yesterday in the programming example, I just created one example. I just created one example where I was just creating one thread. So you can create multiple threads also. You can create a thread called T1. You can create a thread called T2. You can create a thread called T3. And for each of the threads, you can start them. You can call T1.start, T2.start, T3.start. So all these things are also possible. You just try that. So I just shown the example of only one thread example. So in the coming classes, I'll show with the multiple things also. I'll also create three threads, and for each of the thread, we can print some data. But one thing is, the order of execution will not be always common. See, first time the T1 will, since that thread will be executing in a very faster environment, so it is not that the T1 will start printing, T2 will start printing, then T3 will start printing. So the execution can happen in any order. First T3 can start its work. See, for example, it is like the data can be printed in any order. So that is the one thing. So you cannot assume that first thread T1, if we have three threads, T1, T2, T3. So we are given some task of printing. So the order can be anything. So it is not that first T1 will complete its task, followed by T2, followed by T3. No, it can be like interleaved also. So first T1 will print three numbers, and it will go to the sleep state. So in that time, T2 will print the three numbers or four numbers or whatever number it is possible. So like this, if you run a program which contains multiple threads, the output will not be common. Why? Because the printing, the order of execution of the thread, it is decided by the operating system. So you, every time you run, you will get the different outputs. So okay, so this is regarding regarding the thread states. I'll just revise the thread state. So this is important also. So you would have seen this, the same thing in operating system also, but we'll revise this Java thread model. So why this Java thread model, why we are using this thread model, in the sense, see, most of the execution in Java will depend on the thread itself. It will depend on the thread for executing many things, and also all the libraries, all the class libraries which are used in Java are designed by keeping this multi-threading concept. So why Java will use thread, because to enable, so to make the environment to be asynchronous. So why Java will use this thread concept? Because to make the environment to be asynchronous, so thereby reducing the inefficiency. If you want to know how this inefficiency will be reduced, means it is like you can see a system, you can check a single system which will use an approach called the event loop with polling. So a single thread, what is this method? So what is this model? Means if you want to know how the thread will help in achieving the efficiency, means so we have a single thread which will run infinitely. So what it will do means it will just keep on checking the single event queue to decide what operations to do next. So once this queue returns with some message, like it returns with some message like that's a signal, it will return with some signal, we're telling that we have the file which is ready to be read, and that time the control will be transferred to the event handler. So until this, nothing can happen in the system. See, for example, I'll just explain this with the diagram. We have one thread. We have only one thread, which will keep on checking, which will keep on checking the event queue for knowing what operations to do. See, one thing can be like, we have only one system, and if that system has to be used by multiple people, means they have to wait until the first person finishes the job. For example, we have one Excel sheet in this system which needs to be updated by 10 people. So what is the drawback in this? Until the first person completes this this task of updating the Excel, the other 9 has to wait. So suppose this Excel is in a drive, suppose this Excel is shared among 10 people, means in a Google Drive or somewhat online platform, so all the 10 people can update simultaneously. The same logic here, we have one thread. So that thread will it will keep on checking whether any event is there to be executed. So if we have some event, means if we have that some event, means it will wait until you get the control of doing that event from the CPU scheduler. So in this time, the CPU will not perform any other task. It will just remain idle. So this mechanism is wasting the CPU time because it is waiting for some resource. So it is waiting for some resource because of which the time is getting wasted. So all this process can be eliminated by making use of the thread concept. Multiple threads can run. So when T1 is waiting for certain resources, the CPU will be idle. So in that time, instead of wasting the CPU time for T1, T2 can make use of that CPU time, so that thereby keeping the CPU busy, so which in turn will not waste the CPU cycle. So we have several states. So in order to do that itself, we are using threads which will have several states, like it can be running state, it can be the suspended state, it can be the terminated state. So all these threads are there. So what this thread model will help means, it will help in reducing the inefficiency by preventing the wastage of CPU cycles. So this is regarding the thread model. So we have thread priorities. So we have three priorities in Java. One is the maximum priority, minimum priority, and the default priority. So minimum, maximum, and norm, N-O-R-M. We'll be using min, max, and norm constant to indicate the priority for a thread. So minimum priority, maximum priority, and default priority. So what is the usage of this minimum priority, maximum priority means? I told you the thread can be in many states. A thread can be in the running state, a thread can be in the waiting state, a thread can be in the suspended state, a thread can be in the terminated state also. For example, we have two threads, thread one and thread two. So here T1 is having low priority and T2 is having high priority. For example, initially T1 will be in the running state and T2 has not been created or T2 is in the waiting state. When the T2 gets ready for execution, when T2 gets ready for the execution, so this thread T1, which is already running, will go to the wait state. It will go to the wait state and the control will be given to the thread T2 because of thread priority. So what is this thread priority means? A high priority thread will be given the CPU time for its execution when compared with the threads with lower priority. So it is like an example can be like VVIPs. You can know that in some places the VVIPs or very important persons will get preference when compared to the common people. So like that. So high priority thread, when the high priority thread is ready for the execution, the low priority thread will be moved to the waiting state and the priority will be given to the high priority thread for execution. So in Java, so how it is related to Java? So Java will assign priority to each thread. So Java will assign priority to each thread that will decide how the thread will be treated. So thread priority is a relative one. So thread priority is a relative one with respect to one another. If someone is having 5 as the thread value and another thread is having 2 as the priority value, then the one who is having 5 will be considered as a thread with higher priority compared with the thread having the priority number 2. For example, the same scenario, the thread having priority 5 is compared with a thread having priority 9. Now thread 5 will become the low priority thread and thread 9 will become the thread having the priority number 9 will become the high priority thread. So priorities are the integer values which will give the priority of one thread with respect to another thread. Higher priority thread means it will not run faster. Only thing is it will be given priority to use CPU. And lower priority means it will not run slower. Only thing is it is not given preference. Here the only thing is the preference is given with respect to the usage of CPU. So a low priority thread is running, or a low priority thread is making use of CPU. Suddenly the high priority thread will be ready to run. So in that case, the thread which is running will be moved to the waiting state and the higher priority thread will be given preference. So this concept we will call it as context switching. So what do you mean by context switching? Means you're moving the thread from one state to the another state. So one state to the another state. So this we will call it as context switch. So that is, you are moving from running state to the waiting state. That process is known as context switch. So we have rules which will determine when the context switching can take place, So one rule is the thread will voluntarily give the control. So when it is waiting for the CPU, when I'm waiting for the CPU or when I'm executing the block sleep function. So at that time, the thread will give the control to the CPU. The thread, if it wants to execute, means it has to take control of the CPU time. So the thread is making use of the CPU. So it is performing its execution. So once its operation is done, it will go to the terminated state. So when executing some process, it might need the help of an input from the user, that is IO devices. It might need some data from the user. So at that time, it will give the control to the CPU, it will give the control to the CPU and it will go to the waiting state. So this is one thing. So this is here, the thread itself is telling, I will only go from one state to another state. I will only change the state from running state to the waiting state. So this is one way the thread is voluntarily giving the control. So in this situation, the context switch will take place. So the second situation So when the thread is ready to give, when the thread, so we have, so for example, thread T1, the thread T1 was in the running state and it is waiting for some input. So now thread T1 has went to waiting state. It has went to the waiting state. So now if we have T2, T3 and T4 threads, and we have three more threads which are waiting to make use of this CPU, meaning it is, these three threads are ready for running. So in that situation, whatever thread is having highest priority, that will be given CPU. So that will be given the CPU time for its execution. So the highest priority thread which is ready to run will be given the CPU. So we had thread T1 which was running, but because it was waiting for some input from the user or from or someone or because of calling the sleep function, it went to the waiting state. So now once it is in the waiting state, we have three more threads, T2, T3, T4. So if these three threads are ready to run, so in this the one which is having highest priority will be given preference in making use of the CPU. So this is one situation. The second situation we will call it as preventive multitasking means we have T1, T2, T3 threads. So that T1 is having priority 5, T2 is having priority 7. T1 is having priority 5, T2 is having priority 7, and T3 is having priority 9. So T1 is initially a running state, and this will be the waiting state. So initially T2 and T3, they are not ready to make use of this CPU. They are not in the ready to run state. They are not in the ready to run state. So T5 will be using the CPU. T5 is ready to run. T1 is ready to run. So T1 will be in the running state. T1 will be in the running state. Suddenly, now T2 is in ready to run state. So at that time, what this processor will do now, even though T1 is running, it will remove this T1 from the running state and it will push that to the waiting state. And now T2 will start making use of CPU. So this we will call it as preemptive multitasking. The one who is having higher preference, or higher priority is made to make use of CPU. So this is the second, situation where the context switch can take place. See, for example, one example can be like, we have one. So someone is using the system. A student is using the system. We'll assume that a student is using the system and is performing some is practicing some programming like that. Suddenly the faculty wants to use that system. So he will come. So initially the faculty was not, there is only one system, and there was no necessity for faculty to use that system, but the student was having the necessity, so he was using that system. So suddenly, because of some work, the faculty now has the necessity to use that system. So at that time, the student will make a room for the faculty to use that system. So the priority is given to the faculty. The same way, we had two threads, T1 and T2. T1 was not, at that time, T2 was having highest priority, but it was not in a ready to run state. But T1, even though it was having lower priority, it was in a ready to run state. So the CPU, preference or the CPU was given to T1. So T1 was in the running state. So when T2 became ready, to make use of the CPU, suddenly even though the T1 was using the CPU, it was pushed to the waiting state and the control was given to the T2 for making use of CPU. So this we will call it as context switching, where a thread which is having higher priority will be given the CPU, no matter whether the thread which is having lower priority, whether it is using or not. So the preference will be given to the thread which is having higher priority. So this is the second second method. Okay. So what will happen? So this we will call it as preemptive multitasking. So then how to handle the situation? So okay, this was a situation where T1 was having lower priority and T2 was having higher priority. So what if T1 and T2 are both are having the same values? When? So in cases where two threads are having the same priority and both are competing for making use of CPU. So in that situation, the priority will be equal. The priority will be equal among two threads. So it will be shared in a round robin fashion. So it will be shared. The CPU will be shared in a round robin fashion. So like in the sense, T1 use the CPU for 5 seconds. After that, give to T2. T2 use the CPU for 5 seconds and then later return the control to the T1. So this T1 and T2, they will make use of the CPU. They will share the CPU in specified time duration or time slices in a round robin fashion. So that is one thing. So that is also the situation whenever we are having threads which are having highest priority, like priority where both the priorities are same. So any doubts? So is it understood? See, is this concept clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we had what we have seen till now means one is the threaded model. So threaded model means why we are using the threaded model in Java. So the one main reason is to prevent the wastage of CPU cycle, and the second one is the states related to the threads, and after that the thread priorities. So we have minimum priority, maximum priority, and the default one. So minimum will be 1 in Java and maximum will be 10, and the default will be 5. So default value. That is regarding the values with respect to the priorities and how the control can be transferred. One thing is the thread itself will voluntarily give the control, and in the second one is the preference will be given to the higher priority thread compared to the lower priority thread. So these are the thread priorities. So why we are using multi-threading? So why we are using multi-threading in Java? By using this multi-threaded approach, multiple operations can be done at the same time, which will save the time. And also, each thread is independent. Each thread is independent of each other, and it need not wait for other threads, thereby preventing the wastage of resources. And also if one thread, for example, if one thread fails also, if we have three threads, suddenly thread 2 failed. So even though the thread 2 has failed, the thread T1 and T3 will start working. It will continue its task. So that's why this the multi-threaded model is being used in Java. And also we have some functions which we should know. So whenever we are using this thread means we have some functions which we should know. So already we have seen three functions. One is the sleep function, the second one is the run function, and the third one is start function. start function. So these are the functions which are related to threads. So what the sleep function will do means it will make the thread pause for a few for the specified amount of time given by the user. So it will sleep, it will make the thread to sleep for a specified duration of time provided by the user. So what is the usage of start method? Start method means it will start the execution of the threads. The start method can be used to start the execution of thread. And run method, so what run method will do means it will contain the action for the thread. It will contain the action for the thread or the logic for the thread. So in addition to these three basic methods, so in the next class, you'll be seeing about a method called join method. Join method, how to use the join method in threads. And also we have is alive method, suspend method, resume method. So we have so many functions. So in the next level, we'll see how this join and is alive method works. And also priority, when we talk about the thread priority, we can get the priority of a thread by using this get priority function. And also you can give priority through the thread by using set priority function. So these are the some functions which we will see in the next class. So I'll just stop the class now. So any doubts?